Boys were arguing about whose dad was the best. And one kid said, "My dad is so cool, he knows the exact day when he's going to die." The other kid said, "No way, how could he know that?" The first kid said, "The judge told him." Barbara Walters did a story on gender roles in Iraq several years before the war. She noticed that women walked about 10 feet behind their husbands. Well, later, she returned to Iraq and observed that men now walk several yards behind their wives. And she approached one of the women and said, "This is wonderful. Can you tell me how your newfound freedoms have enabled women to achieve this reversal of roles? Why men now walk several yards behind their wives?" And the Iraqi woman said, "Landmines." Too soon? I don't know. The father of five won a toy in a raffle. He called his kids together and asked which one of them should get the toy. He said, "So let me say, who's the most obedient, who never talks back to mom, who does everything she says?" And one of the kids says, "Okay, Dad, you can keep the toy." Well, today is the day we honor fathers. That's me. You can honor me, and you can honor all the other dads here. Exodus 20, verse 12 says, "Honor your father and your mother." It comes straight from the top 10, the 10 commandments. Now, on Mother's Day, we always hear about how great moms are, how loving, how selfless, how nurturing. And on Father's Day, we tend to hear how lousy dads are. They're too busy, they're not nurturing, they're irresponsible. And sometimes that description fits, like the Indonesian father who claims his two-year-old is addicted to cigarettes. Mohammed Rizal said his son is hooked on tobacco after he had his first cigarette at age 18 months. He says, "No, I'm not worried about his health. He's fine. Besides, he cries and throws tantrums when we don't let him smoke." So there are some bad dads around, like this guy here. He's probably not a Father of the Year candidate, I would guess. Same with this guy. Probably not necessarily good fathers. And if you grew up with an absent dad, or especially an abusive dad, you know, I can't imagine how tough that would have been for you, and how Father's Day is probably not such a joyous occasion for you. But I also realize that some of us here have lost fathers, maybe recently, or like me, a number of years ago. But I believe that the vast majority of dads try to be and would really love to be good dads. They would love to be great dads. And that's the place to start, I think, about being a good dad, is in our verse for today from Psalm 103, verse 13, "As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him." You know, as a dad now of 20 years, I guess, I've learned that children, they need discipline, they need structure. They need someone when they're small to provide for them. They need someone to protect them. But, you know, I think what they need above all other things is to be loved. By your actions and your words, dads, grandfathers, your children, regardless of their age, and your grandchildren need to be one clear on one thing, crystal clear, and that is that they matter to you, that they're important to you, that you love them, that you care about them. Well, now Jana is going to come up and interview a couple of dads and three kids, and I'm going to go on record that I cannot be held responsible for anything that happens from this point forward in the service.
I'm just trying to save the service from this point on. Well, I want to ask Brian Toomey to come up. He's going to be the first dad that we interview today. So come on up, Brian. So, Brian, you are on the fast track here. You went from being married to instant family, right? You know, you married Radonna. Radonna already had two kids, so you're an instant dad. Why don't you tell us about that transition from not being a dad to being a dad?
Well, simple as I can put it, you can all hear me anyway. Simple as I can put it, it went from my focus being all about myself to being all about others. And I really realized that, you know, what I did and the example I set is really important. So my focus just became all about, you know, what's our family life look like? So, and I thought to myself, when I was first starting to date her and stuff, I thought, this would be no big deal. She's got a hold of the kids, and then they all listen to her, and it'll just flow smooth. so I'm learning still to be a dad. So
great.
I have to learn how to play that role. So.
Great. So you and Radonna have been married about 2.5 years or 3 years? What is it?
2.5.
2.5. And then you announced a new addition to your family about a year ago, and that was Lyric, of course. And we have a couple of pictures here of Radonna looking like a supermodel after Lyric, them in the hospital. And then I'll never forget the first time I got to hold Lyric. I mean, right when she was born, it was just amazing. Yeah. And I was even in Cabo and got to hold her right at that moment when she was born. But Brian, tell us a little bit about Lyric coming into the family and what that's been like for you. I think this should work now.
Yeah. Oh, I'm much louder. Okay, so my first thought when I saw her was just, she's a little blank slate, just a little sponge that's going to absorb everything. And it really hit me deeply. I wanted to do everything that I could to love and protect her. So, I mean, that part actually hit me with the other two kids, too. There will be times when there's just no reason to really be joyful throughout the day that I saw, and Avery would just be hopping around, and I look at her and think, that's God's joy right there, you know? So, anyway, that's kind of how it affected me. That's what it made me think of when I first held her. So
Brian, what are you doing in this picture?
That's the diaper check.
So you do get smelled to see if things are okay or if you need to.
Yeah, they powder the diapers really well these days, you know. So you got to.
You got to really sniff pretty hard.
You got to really take it in. Plus, I just wanted to see that later, later in life.
So, Brian, are there other ways that you feel like being a dad has changed you?
I don't know. It really has. I've been a very, very, very selfish person for a lot of my life, and that's the biggest way it's influenced me. So it just made me want to do for others and think about those that are around me, how I'm affecting them. So.
Yeah, well, you certainly have a beautiful family.
Thank you.
So if you could give your kids one piece of advice, what about God, about the Bible, what would that be?
The first thing that came to my mind when I thought about that was that God does forgive. And I feel like in my spiritual walk, that's kind of where I'm still walking right now. I've been a part of this church for a long time in person, but not in spirit. And I'm still really trying to internalize that. So I would want everybody here to know that no matter what you've done, no matter where you've been, God will forgive you. So that love is available if you'll let it in. So that's what I want my kids to know, that I love them and that God will always love them. So
that's great. And, you know, kids often view God how they see their fathers and through their father's love and compassion and so forth. And I think you're on the right track there.
Thank you.
Let's hear it for Brian. Thank you. Great job. And I want to ask Michael, Megan, and Matthew to come up here. This is the scary part, you guys, that Russ was referring to. So I have a few pictures here of some of our family vacations from Cabo. This was one from last year. And then we have a pyramid that we do every year. And here's a picture of the pyramid. The first one's from 2009. You can see how that pyramid's changing a little bit. Pretty soon Russ is going to be on top. And then it keeps changing. And then here's another family picture that was taken again in 2009 out at Jacob's Ladder. But we asked our kids to come up today because we thought they might say some interesting things about their dad. So the first question I want to start with is with Michael. All of them will answer. What are a couple of things that you can think of about your dad that really annoy you? And we have to be done by 11:30, so keep it short.
I'll keep it to three. Ice crunching, he can't hear, and he can't drive.
Wow. Okay. Megan?
I'm going to have to say the ice crunching, too, and this little move that you do in the car. Annoying. And when I call my dog Maddie, I say, Maddie, and he goes, what? Because he thinks I'm saying daddy.
Okay, Matthew.
The ice crunching again, not using his turn signal and licking his lips when he's talking.
Yeah, yeah, he licks his lips a lot when he talks, doesn't he? Oh, Megan's got another.
And when he says, "I'm so proud of you, Megan."
Well, we probably have more, but we're going to move on. What's something that you really admire about your dad?
I admire that he can turn a vision into reality, and he can build something that he wants to be built, like the vision of the church.
I admire his ability to keep secrets. He has, not like that, he has secrets from people that have even passed, and he's like, "I'm not telling it, I pinky swore," whatever. So he's a secret keeper, and his ability to spend time with all of us individually. Like, I'll go to his office and ask if we can go to lunch, and he says, "Now?" I say, "Yeah," and he's like, "Okay."
Playing basketball, and Russell said that was out on me. That was me. He'll just, you know, be honest about that. Well, this one's for Matthew. So, Matthew, what is something meaningful that you've done with your dad or that you've talked to your dad about?
I talked about asking Jesus into my heart with him.
That's pretty meaningful. That's a big one right there. This one's for Megan. Megan, what are some things that you have learned by watching your dad just do life that's impacted you?
The way that he treated my grandma, Grammio, his mom, just really impacted me. And I wouldn't want anything more but for a guy to treat me how he treated her. I just think it was really special.
Yeah, and he was a great son to Grammio. She was here today, she would say, greatest in the kingdom, right? So, Megan, tell us what's happening in this picture here. This is something special you and Daddy did.
When I was little, Daddy made me a song, and he'd set me on his desk and sing it to me.
Do you want to sing it for us?
Yeah, it's called "Megan is a Good Girl."
How does it go, Megan?
Here we go. It says, "Megan is a good girl. Megan is a good girl. She's got a papa and a Nana. She's got a brother and another brother."
Okay, that's good. Thank you for that solo, Megan. I'm sure they're going to be calling you for a music tryout soon. So, Megan, we have another picture here. And, you know, Daddy's always tried really hard to do what you've asked him to do, especially on special occasions. What happened here?
Yeah, I think this was my 13th birthday party, and I wanted nothing more but the pool to be hot pink. And he tried his best, and it turned out like someone got murdered in it. No one wanted to swim in it. Everyone was too scared to swim at my pool party.
All the kids were going, "Oh, I don't know." And Bryce was like, "It was supposed to be hot pink. It says hot pink on the liquid thing. I just put too much in." Anyway, he tried, right? So, Matthew, I think this was around Father's Day one year. So we were going to take a family picture, and we had someone up high in the condo, like on the third floor, and we told all the kids, "Look up, you guys, look up, they're going to take our picture." Matthew, you really looked up, didn't you? What was that all about? Just did it. So tell us about the second picture, Matthew. Why did this happen? When did this happen?
I do that every day that you're not home.
Not only have I told him not to jump on the bed, don't fly and land on the bed, right? So I found this out by finding the picture. So you're caught now, right? You and Daddy both are caught now. Okay, so another question. You know, you guys have a great dad, obviously. But if you could pick any other dad in the whole wide world, you know, we have a family picture. And we've talked about occasionally, if Daddy's gone, what our family might look like. And the kids voted. So who did you guys pick?
Phil.
Yeah, we went with Phil.
Yeah. So we just wanted to see what it might look like. I think he blends in okay. So that's the plan. If you guys don't know, Phil's the one who comes and speaks sometimes if Russ is gone. So the kids really like to tease Russ about him taking over, and I guess a lot of ways, I don't know. Well, changing gears just a little bit, you guys have a really great grandpa too. And he's here today. My dad's here today. So why don't you guys say something that you admire about Papa?
I admire how good he is with people and relating to everyone and just making everyone feel comfortable and like they're important.
I admire his honesty and how genuine he is and how just thoughtful he is to people and anyone that he meets.
I really admire his work ethic. He gets up in the morning every day and he does the same thing for years and years.
Yeah, he's the hardest worker I know, I tell you. Well, let's give these guys a big round of applause. Thanks for coming up here. So I want to ask, oh yeah, Matthew has a special gift for his daddy for Father's Day. I forgot, Matthew. Russ, Matthew has a gift for you to make up for all the comments that they just did. So I want to ask my dad to come on up. Daddy, come on up here. You'll have to come up this way right here. So this is my dad, in case you guys haven't met him before. And here, right here. I know, they are taller. My dad has actually had 2 broken hips at different times. One time a cow ran over him. He's pretty tough. And another time he was opening a gate, and I think he slipped, and a cow got him that way too. Anyway, I'm glad that he's here today and that we could take the opportunity to interview him as well. So you've been around a while, huh?
What?
You've been around a while. I mean, almost 80 years?
79 years.
It'll be 80 in August. So why don't you tell us a little bit about your growing up years? You know, what was life like back then, way back then? What did you go to church? What was your family like?
My mother was part Cherokee, my dad was part Choctaw. I was born under an oak tree in Pleasant Hill, Oklahoma, which means good water. And we lived about a half a mile from the church, and my mother would walk me to church, and just before we got there, I could hear my grandmother singing all the way down the road. And I was involved in Christianity ever since. I was baptized when I was 10 year old, along with 16 other kids, and there's an article in our hometown paper about it. But my mother and my daddy were two of the greatest people I ever met, and they believed in going to church and making your mind, and it was yes sir, no ma'am, and yes ma'am. One of the big things that happened at church one time, I was doing something I wasn't supposed to, and I climbed over a seat and fell and skinned my nose. So I had to behave next time I went to church. I was a lot better.
You're probably afraid there. So you have 2 sisters, and your dad's been gone for quite a while. How old were you when your dad passed away?
I think I was 25. Wow. He was the most amazing fellow I ever met. He believed in working for what you get. Nobody owes you nothing. You earned what you got, and he was that kind of man and taught me to be able to make it on my own. And he believed I could do anything, and that's the way I've been with my kids.
Now, Daddy, you were going to college, and didn't you stop going to college to go back home to help your dad to pay bills to get a job?
Well, I was in the Army when my dad really got bad sick, and I stayed a year. They let me out of the Army to be able to provide for my mother and dad. So when I came back, I went to work in Oklahoma City at a parts place and helped them to have money to survive on.
So I asked you last night, what is one of your favorite church songs or a hymn?
Well, there's so many, I don't know. Go Tell It on the Mountain and Amazing Grace, and I could name a bunch of them that really excites me and lets me know how to know and understand the Lord.
Do you want to do like Megan and sing a couple of them real quick?
Not today.
No, not today, okay. So my mom's here today too. We call her Nana. So how did you meet my mom, and how many years have you guys been married?
Well, she thought she'd been married 54 years, but I got questioned and I went to courthouse and come to find out they give us a learner's permit.
Not a license.
Yeah, not a license. No license.
That's too bad. You've been practicing for nothing.
We've been I was rodeoing back then, roping calves at rodeos, and me and a buddy pulled up to Dairy Queen one night and to get something to drink, and he said, "You seen them two old gals from Arkansas?" I said, "No, I hadn't been looking for them." I looked over and I thought, "Boy, there's one of them looks pretty good for an Arkansas-er." And she come jumping to pick up, and I hadn't got her out since.
I wonder if that's really the way that story happened.
But they say a cowboy's entitled to a good woman, a good horse, and a good dog, and I've had them all.
And good kids.
And good grandkids. Them spoiled kids up here a while ago, wasn't it?
I know.
Yeah.
A lot of kids up here. Well, do you remember the day that I was born? I mean, it was like 29 years ago, so maybe you can still remember that. What were you doing that day? Because if you can't remember, I found out.
I don't know. I can't remember.
You were with Mom at her parents' house. And she said that they went to the hospital about 4 o'clock in the morning. That's probably the earliest I've ever gotten up. So I was an early riser that one day. But how has being a dad changed you? You know, I have one brother. He's 3.5 years younger than me. How's being a dad changed you?
Well, when you was born, I knew I had to go to work to feed the family. So I was, at one time, I was testing cattle 40 hours a week for the state of Oklahoma. I was trying to get my rock crusher to going, loading trucks all night. I was rodeoing from Michigan to Maryland to Georgia every weekend about. And Brahman cattle is, my dad started in 1947. And I picked it up, Charlie and I did, in 1968. And it has been amazing. Some of our cattle have won some of the big shows like Fort Worth, San Antonio, and Houston.
Yeah. My dad, you know, started out cows and rodeoing, and you went to rodeos just all around the state, right?
I announced rodeos in 17 states. I announced the world's largest open rodeo in Texas. I announced the world's largest bull riding for 20 consecutive years. And I announced the International Finals Rodeo in Tulsa back when it started several years ago. So my rodeo career has really been amazing. I've introduced, met, and been on the bus with George Strait, Loretta Lynn, Dolly Parton, Nat Stuckey.
You're on the bus with Dolly Parton?
Yeah.
That didn't sound like a good idea.
Well, you was there.
I was, so.
Yeah.
Well, I always laugh.
Your little brother is one that kept the deal. They had this stage that they pulled out there right quick, and they let all the singers get out there, and her little brother, Michael, he wanted to go out, his mother let him come up there where I was at, he wanted to go out there in front of the stage and play with the kids, you know, and I said, no, you stay up here, I hadn't got time to chase you. And after it's over with, somebody asked Michael, they said, "What'd you think about Dolly Parton?" He said, "I don't know. Daddy wouldn't let me see the front of her."
That's horrible. Oh my gosh, I totally lost my train of thought on that one. Well, I remember, you know, going with you to some rodeos, and that's what we called vacation. Occasionally, not even every summer, but we would go with my dad on a rodeo, and it was such a big deal to us to get to stay in a hotel with a swimming pool. And I remember, it's funny the things that you remember as a kid, isn't it? But I remember, I mean, you know, we always had plenty to eat, we always had clothes to wear, we didn't go without. But I remember, you know, we didn't have a lot of money. And my mom would always bring like an electric skillet and a toaster. And in the hotel room, she would make breakfast for all of us. And we would eat in the hotel room, and then we'd go swimming later. And I always tell people I got my start to talking with my dad. Because after the rodeo was over, when they were doing all the re-rides and everything, he would let me announce those. So he was teaching me at an early age how to talk. Aren't you glad that you taught me how to talk?
Yeah, I remember one time the world's largest bull riding, you did the American flag for me.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Before I forget it, I'd like to mention that I announced rodeos for 30 years, and I give the invocation that every rodeo I worked, except the ones the committee had a preacher designated to do it. So I hadn't done much for the Lord, but I do know him.
That's good. That's what's important, right? And now you don't even have to pray at family get-togethers because I married Russ. That's what he's for, right?
Well.
Now hang on. We're gonna come back. We're going to come back to Russ, so hang on just a second. We're not quite ready for him yet. So we have a few cow pictures here. My dad has, how many cows do you have? Do you know?
Probably Raymond. 400 or 500.
Yeah, lots of cows, and those are kind of his babies. And then we have a picture of the rock-crushing sign, Story Brahmin Ranch, Quality Rock. That's the rock-crushing business he owns. And then the one on the right is with our kids. Megan's in the very top. I thought she was left out. But that's one of the loaders that my dad owns for the rock crushing business. And I'm really proud of him. You know, like the kid said earlier, his work ethic has always been amazing to me. And I think that's where I got mine from, because he has worked Thank you. He's worked really hard for our family. And I know there's been days and years he's been so tired he can barely move, but he certainly has a really, really great work ethic. Okay, so you're getting ahead of me. So I didn't bring very many boys home, did I?
Oh, thank goodness.
No, I didn't. I didn't bring a lot of them home because most of them I couldn't brought home. No, I didn't bring a lot of them home. But do you remember one day I was in college for my third time? And I was working on my doctorate here at OU, and I brought this guy home with me, and I just want to talk about, do you remember the day that you met Russ? I mean, in your whole life, you wanted me to marry a cowboy.
Right.
And the whole drive to Idabel, I kept thinking my dad's going to be so disappointed in me. He's not a cowboy. He's not a cowboy. I even thought maybe I could dress him up a little bit. Look like a cowboy. But what did you think about me bringing Russ home and marrying a pastor? What did you think about that?
I told you when you told me that we had enough pastors already for the cattle.
Minister.
Different pastor.
Yeah, yeah. So what did you think about that?
Well, I thought Charlene needed a son-in-law, and he come there and got on a horse first thing, and of course, when he got bucked off, I knew he wasn't a cowboy.
Yeah, even if I'd had him dressed right, it wasn't going to help.
No, it's been amazing. I'm proud of him. I've never had Jenna Lee to call me and say, Daddy, come get us. We don't have something to eat, or Russ has been mean to us, or done something to the kids, and when I go to sleep at night and say a prayer, I don't worry about the grandkids. Because I know that Russ takes care of Jenna Lee and them, and I'm certainly proud of him and honored to have him as my wife's son-in-law.
See, Russ, now you know. And for those of you who want to know the horse story, when I took him down and we were dating, there was a horse out in the pasture, and it didn't have just a horse, didn't have a bridle saddle. And I said, hey, Russ, take my picture. I'm going to get on this horse. So I got on the horse. Horse stands there. Russ takes a bunch of pictures. And I said, how about you get on the horse, and I'll take your picture? And he was like, okay. And my dad's sitting out on the front porch just watching us. And I was 28 years old, you know. And Russ was like 38. So he gets up on the horse, and the moment his bottom hit the back of that horse took off running and becking. I've never seen my dad laugh as hard as I saw him laugh that day. And then somebody called and said, I heard Jana brought a guy home. Well, it was a big talk of the town. And all I heard my dad say on the phone was, yep, well, he ain't a cowboy. So that was. So I'm glad that you're proud of Russ, even though he's not a cowboy. So a couple of more questions. What are some traits, Daddy, that you've tried to instill in my brother and I? You know, in other words, what are some important things that you've tried to teach us?
Don't nobody owe you nothing. You need to work for what you get. Yeah, it says, I believe in the Bible, Russ, that you make your living by the sweat of your brows or something like that. But anyway, you've got to be good to people, respect them. And I was raised when you said yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am. And when we walked down, when our teachers walked down the hall in high school and grade school, we got over out of the way and respect them. Now the teachers are scared to go down the hallways, and that's not right. I wouldn't be a teacher for $1 million a month. Sure wouldn't. It's amazing to how things have changed. They talk about how smart these grandkids are nowadays. I bet there's not a teenager in here knows how to play Mama Peg or hopscotch or take a piece of red clay and make a horse or a truck to play with every day or jump the rope.
Probably not, but they know how to work an iPhone.
Well, that's their problem.
My dad has a flip phone. We're trying to show him a few.
My phone don't do anything but talk, and I answer it.
Yeah, and he answers it. That's right. Well, I do remember, you know, my dad, man, he's like Mr. Nice, loosened up guy now. When I was a kid, he was really strict. And I remember school mornings, because I've never been a morning person. My mom would try to wake us up. She'd go back like 10 times, get up. And then she would tell my dad, and I would hear, because he always wears boots, I would hear the footprints coming down the hallway, and I jumped up, and I was like, I'm awake. I did that because one morning, I didn't get up when I heard him walking down the hallway, and I woke up to a huge glass of water poured on me. He did, you guys. He poured water on me. I've had to go to counseling for a long time to get over that one, Daddy. But he did teach us respect. And I think that is a huge value. And he also taught us a great work ethic. And my dad always wanted us to go to church. If he couldn't go, he was like telling my mom, you take them to church, you guys go. And it's always been, you know, a big part of our lives. So switching gears just a little bit, grandkids came into your life in 1997. And Michael was the first grandkid. And, you know, he thinks he's the most special because he was the first. But here's all your grandkids. You have 5 grandkids. My brother has 2. We have 3. So tell us a little bit about your grandkids. Why are you proud of them?
Well, as long as they respect their parents and go to church and believe in the good Lord, well, they won't have any problem. And if they work for what they get, well, they'll know how they got it. Like I've said many times, nobody owes you anything if you're healthy, and the wealthiest people in the world are the healthy ones, right? That's what I think. And it's been amazing to have those 5 grandkids and watch the different things they do. Some of them might be cowboys, some preachers or bull riders or who knows, but long as they have respected the people and their parents and take care of their parents, they'll have an amazing life and stay busy like I did. It'll work.
I remember Michael was the first grandkid, so I guess he was about 6 or 8 months old. My dad was in Oklahoma City at the rodeo, so he picked Michael up and was going to take him to Ida Belle. And he had to change Michael's diaper on the side of the road. And my dad kept thinking, somebody's going to arrest me. Somebody's going to think that I stole this kid, you know. But he and Michael were super close, especially when he was little. Michael would wear a cowboy hat, and my dad thought he was going to get the cowboy, I think, after all. Well, he would cry all the way back to Norman after he'd be in Idaho, and he'd just go, Papa, Papa, crying. And every time we get him calmed down, if we saw a cow, he'd start all over again. Papa, Papa, crying again. But it's been really fun to see both my mom and dad with grandkids. Been really fun.
Yeah, changing that diaper. When I got home, your mama come out there and she was just tickled to death to see him, and I was tickled to death to see her too.
I think you had it on backwards.
I used my handkerchief, and I said, "You get up, this stinking sucker, because I've had enough of him."
Sure, but Michael's enjoying this.
But when he he'd come down and stay with us a little bit in the summer, and we'd have a good time. He was learning my ways of life, you know, and not long after that, well, Janet Lee had him brought him back home, and him and her was walking across the Walmart parking lot, and all of a sudden, he just shut down right there in the middle of the parking lot and used the bathroom. Janet said, "You can't do that." He said, "Me and Papa need to go. We go when we get ready."
Poor, poor Michael, he'll never come back to church. Michael, that wasn't on the plan.
I know y'all are getting tired hearing about me, but I'd like to say one thing right quick. I'm awfully proud of our grandkids and the kids, and especially Janet Lee. She went to school 8 years to be able to out-talk her mama, and it was very expensive, and I thought it was over then, but don't forget this. When they leave home, I'm still paying child support on both of them. But I wouldn't have them any other way. I was unbelievably fortunate to have two kids and a wife and the family that I've lived, and it's been hard. I used to borrow money to pay my hands and bum cigarettes off of them, and it may happen again, but I shouldn't say it, but we own 1,700 acres and got 25 families that live out of our business, and we all work. And I'm so proud. And can I plug the book?
Yeah.
Well, this lady down there, she come by one day and said, "Can I write a story about you?" And I said, "Yeah, I guess so, if we can find enough stuff." She said, "What I hear of, we can find enough stuff." Anyway, we're the 32nd oldest active Brahma breeder in the United States of Brahman cattle, the big long-eared cattle with humps on them. And our rock crusher is amazing. We sell like 400,000 and 500,000 tons of rock a year going to build roads and pads. And my rodeo career was amazing to me. I got to see and do things. I got to go through the the Capitol building in Washington, D.C. And I don't know, I can't believe the good Lord was as good to me as that he's been. But and we try to give some of it back. We support a lot of youth. And if this book works out, you might, if you happen to read buy one of them, don't think it's a fatal loss. Yeah, fatal loss. But it'll concern my cattle, my rock crusher, my Indian heritage. One of my great grandparents was Peter Pitchlin, and he was he's buried in Washington, D.C. He was an interpreter for George Washington, and they came down through North Carolina, Mississippi, and one of my grandmothers has got the oldest marked tombstone in the state of Oklahoma, down in southeastern Oklahoma. So my cattle, my rodeo, and all these four things will be put together. And right now, I'm thinking the book will be called The Choctaw Cherokee Cowboy, because of my mother and my daddy and my three sisters. We're going to add the three J's, Judy and Jonna. They were rodeo queens from Miss Rodeo America, runner-up to International Rodeo Queen. Anyway, when we get this book together, if anybody buys one of them, I paid all the expenses, and all the proceeds will go to St. Jude Hospital.
That's great, Daddy. Well, thanks for sharing with us today about some of your life, so hopefully it will help inspire and help some of the other dads here today to kind of reflect on their lives too. And I want to go back to the verse that Russ read when he started the service today, and it comes from Psalms 103:13, and it says, "As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him." And I want to add an extra verse on it as we leave today to think about. "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and your mother." And you know, that word honor is really important, because I'm very fortunate to have parents that are easy to honor. I know some people aren't as fortunate, but I try to honor them in all that I do. And I hope you dads today here feel honored as you're sitting here too. So let's stand for closing prayer, and happy Father's Day. Oh, he wants to say one more thing. Okay, you got to make it quick, Papa.
Say thanks to Russ and Jenna for the hard work that they've done and what they've, this is amazing. I've talked in front of 10,000 people before, but this is one of the amazing things in my life to see this church grow and get back together and do good. Thank you.
All right, thanks, Daddy. All right, let's pray and happy Father's Day again. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for everyone who's here today. And God, thank you for these nuggets of wisdom that we've heard from the dads today and also the ones, God, from the kids who were talking about their dad. And God, as grateful as some of us may be of the Father that we have, we know that there's only one ultimate Father, and God, that's you. And God, we just stand in awe today of all the things that you've created, all the things that you've done. And God, I just pray if there's anyone here today who hasn't asked Jesus to come into their heart, especially the fathers, but everyone today, God, it's just one of the most important, it is the most important thing that they can do. And God, I just pray that you will urge them to do that. And it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.